टू चैनल. नाउ वी आर गोइंग टू स्टार्ट ह्यूमन प्लासेंटा. ह्यूमन प्लासेंटा एट टर्म. सो व्हाट इज दिस ह्यूमन प्लासेंटा एट टर्म? एक्चुअली इफ यू सी द ह्यूमन प्लासेंटा ऑन फीटल साइड एंड मेटरनल साइड, अकॉर्डिंग टू द एरिया दे आर सेम. ऑन मेटरनल साइड एंड फीटल साइड दे आर सेम. बट इफ यू सी अकॉर्डिंग टू द थिकनेस, देन यू विल ऑब्जर्व दैट ऑन द फीटल साइड इट्स लाइक अबाउट फोर फिफ्थ, whereas on the maternal side it is only 1/5. So on fetal side it is 4/5, on maternal side only 1/5. So according to thickness the fetal side is more thicker when compared with the maternal side, but according to the area if you see both are like having the same area. And one more thing is on the fetal side, as I said it's of 4/5, actually it looks a gray color, and as it is on fetal side there will be an umbilical cord in the center. Okay, and it will like a shiny surface, whereas on the maternal side it is only 1/5. It is having actually 15 to 20 cotyledons, or you can say 15 to 20 lobes. Okay, 15 to 20 lobes are present. It is maternal side is like reddish dullish red color without any membranes or cords, and it is having 15 to 20 lobes, and also it has some cotyledons. Even cotyledons are found. So actually, what is this cotyledon? Actually, a cotyledon is a functional unit of the placenta. It is where actually one stem cell of a villi and its branches supply each cotyledon. And remember, cotyledon is present on the maternal side of the placenta. Okay. So these are some features. And next, coming to placentomegaly. So in the name itself, you can see placentomegaly. That is, the placenta has become large. You say this first. To understand this, you need to understand what is the normal placenta thickness. It is like about 2.5 centimeter. Okay, the normal thickness is 2.5 centimeter. So in placenta megaly, what happens is the placenta is greater than 4 centimeters, greater or equal to 4 centimeters. So normally I said it should be 2.5. Now it is 4, or you can say greater than 4. So the placenta is equal to or greater than 4 centimeters, then it is called placentomegaly, that the placenta has become large. So what are the causes in case of diabetes? You have placentomegaly, and also in the case of severe anemia, and also in RH incompatibility, and also you will see in uteroplacental insufficiency. You'll see in hydrops fetalis, and also some virus like cytomegalovirus, some infections like syphilis, and also you will see this in toxoplasmosis. So these are all the different causes of placentomegaly, where placenta is greater than 4 centimeters in the case of diabetes, anemia, RH incompatibility, hydrops fetalis, cytomegalovirus, syphilis, toxoplasmosis. Now coming to the another case, that is a small placenta. Sometimes the placenta is itself looking small. So what are the cases here? The small placenta, you can see this whenever you know there is no trophoblastic invasion. If you remember, in the trophoblastic invasion it converts the high vascular spiral arteries into low resistant, right? So here, as there is no trophoblastic invasion, the placental vessel is incompletely, it is not turning into low resistance, so it is very high resistance. So low blood is coming to the intervillous space. So intervillous space have low blood, small amount of blood. So because of this, the size of this placenta is also decreased. So this case you see especially in preeclampsia, and also in uteroplacentale insufficiency, in IOGR, and also in small baby. Normally the fetus is only small, then in that case also you will see small placenta. So next, coming to methods of placental separation. So how the methods of placental separation are actually of two types. The most common is Skulls type. Okay, this is most common, and the other one is Duncan type. This is less common. So the most common, actually what happens here is, let me draw the diagram, skull type. So for example, this is a uterine cavity. Here actually the placenta is attaching, it is present centrally. So as it is present centrally, when you try to drag the baby downward, it will form a cavity like this, and the blood will stuck here and it will form a clot. So when you drag the baby, the placenta, especially the fetal side of the placenta, that is a grayish color placenta, will come out first, and of course bleeding will be there, but not that much bleeding because already the clot has formed here. So this is most common time. But in the case of Duncan, what happens, the placenta is peripherally attached here. As the placenta is peripherally attached, there will be lot of bleeding from the of course cervix. There will be lot of bleeding, and this is least common. Here if you drag first, you will get the maternal side of the placenta. So that is reddish color, dull reddish color placenta. Here you'll get first, and there is lot of bleeding. Here only less bleeding, and this is also more common, and it is fetal side will come first out. Okay, so this is about this Skulls and Duncan. Now coming to some anomalies of placenta. There are some anomalies of placenta, like the first one is called placenta succinturia. Placenta succinturia. So what happens in placenta succinturia is actually two lobes are formed in the placenta, as we discussed before. Like there are about 15 to 20 lobes on maternal side, right? So actually what happens is one lobe is small, one lobe is big, and in between there is a blood vessel. This type of anomaly is called placenta succinturia. So here with the help of blood vessels, still these both are connected. Okay, and next coming to another one, that is placenta spuria. Placenta spuria, here also there are two unequal lobes, but they are not connected. This is bigger lobe, smaller, but they are not connected by means of any blood vessel. That is placenta spuria. Placenta succinturia, both one is big, one is small, and connected by blood vessel. Next you have placenta bilobata. Bilobata, so in the name itself you can see there are two lobes, but they are of equal size, and also they are connected by blood vessel. This is called placenta bilobata. So that's it. These are the anomalies. So actually in all these anomalies, there will be postpartum hemorrhage. So after removing this kind of placenta with the baby, there will be hemorrhage. So for that we use the management of postpartum curettage. Curettage, we use postpartum curettage as a management. But by doing this curettage, in turn it will form an Asherman syndrome. It will form Asherman syndrome. So now coming to extrachoral placenta. What is extrachoral placenta? So actually in this extrachoral placenta, the fetal side is very small. So for example, you take, this is the fetus side, which is very small, whereas the maternal side is very big. Okay, so as the maternal side is very big, now this maternal side will enclose this fetal side. So it will form a valve-like projection, and fetal side is somewhat lower, and the maternal side is forming a valve-like projection. So this kind is called as circumvallate. Circumvallate, very easy to remember. Valve-like projection is seen, so circumvallate, V for V, valve-like projection, valet. Now coming to circummarginate. So in circummarginate, in the name itself you can see, here also the maternal placenta will be just forming a like margin like this. So like just a ring like structure, a margin. So they both, fetal placenta and maternal placenta, will be on the same level, and just ring like structure is formed. So this is the difference between circumvallate and marginate. In vallate you will see valve like thing, and you will see fetal side is somewhat deeper when compared with maternal side of placenta. But in circummarginate, both are in same level, they are ring like structure. So actually what is the problem with this either circumvallate or circummarginate is, the fetal side is so small, so low blood is going to the fetus. So now what is happening, it is leading to IUGR, and because of this there is very low urine. As very low urine is produced, it is leading to oligohydramnios, which will lead to preterm labor. It will lead to preterm labor, or there are chances of antepartum hemorrhage. Now let us discuss the morbidly adherent placenta. morbidly adherent placenta. So what is morbidly adherent? Here the word morbidly means it is attached in a wrong place. Usually you know, the chorionic villi which is present on the placenta, they will go and attach at the decidua basalis, right? That decidua basalis is nothing but it's in turn present in the endometrium, right? So you know, endometrium is a weak layer, that's why in every menstrual cycle it will be getting shed off, right? So even the placenta can easily get shed off if it is attached to endometrium, that is by means of chorion villi to the decidua basalis. But here in the case of morbidly adherent placenta, what happens is there is chorionic villi which are going and attaching deep into either myometrium or sometime even deep into the serosa layer. You know that our uterus have endometrium as outer layer, next myometrium, next a deep layer serosa. So here the morbidly adherent placenta, our problem is the chorionic villi are going deep into the myometrium and also sometimes into serosa. So now they are not easily shed off, so it will lead to severe postpartum hemorrhage and also many different problems. So what is the main problem here? That is the Nitta Books layer. Actually, this Nitta Books layer, it prevents this all problem. It allows the blastocyst or chorionic villi only to attach either to the endometrium only. It will not allow it to go either into myometrium or serosa. So it's like a limiting layer. It's actually a layer of fibrinoid degeneration, and this is present in decidua basalis. So if it is absent, it will lead to this problem. So now let us see what are the different locations and what are the names. We have placenta accreta. So placenta accreta is where it is, this chorionic villi or blastocyst is attaching just on the superficial layer of myometrium, on superficial layer of myometrium. Next you have placenta increta. Increta is attaching into the myometrium directly. This is superficial, but here directly into myometrium. Next coming to placenta percreta. Percreta is going deep into up to serosa. So the other reasons for this may be not only about Nitta Books layer, also if there is no decidua basalis, then there is no limit for the blastocyst. So they may go like accreta, increta, percreta. Accreta, myometrium, superficial layer. Increta, deep layer of myometrium. Percreta, directly going into the serosa. So these are the main factors. Now let us see what are the risk factors for this. So the risk factors are, it is most important present placenta previa, that is placenta located in lower uterine segments. So risk factor is especially for placenta previa. Already if someone have placenta previa, then they have very risk factor, because placenta previa is like, for example, this is uterine cavity. If the placenta is near the base here, then that is called as placenta previa. And the next one is, second most important is previous history of cesarean section. Previous history of cesarean section. And next one is previous history of curettage. And also previous history of myomectomy and also hysterectomy. So all these are the risk factors which may lead to all these problems, like placenta accreta, placenta increta, placenta percreta, all this. So now coming to diagnosis, the main thing how you can diagnose this all by means of MRI. MRI is a gold standard to check all this. And what findings you will see, especially the subplacental sonolucent area is absent. Subplacental sonolucent means it is actually nothing but decidua basalis. This layer is absent in the MRI. If you see that, then you can say it is causing all these problems. Heterogeneous appearance of placenta can be also seen, and also placental lakes are also seen. Placental lakes and heterogeneous appearance, all this is leading to this problem. So what happens because of this? It will lead to refractory postpartum hemorrhage, PPH, and placenta is also not separated. So how to manage it? So if it is detected after delivery, then it is better to do hysterectomy. So after delivery, so what is hysterectomy? This is complete removal of uterus. Hysterectomy, if it is find out before delivery, then it is better to do cesarean section, and after cesarean section it is better to do again hysterectomy. If someone is not allowing to do hysterectomy, then we may remove as much as placenta as possible and just leave behind, and also monitor beta HCG levels. So this can lead to gestational trophoblast neoplasia later. Next, coming to classical cesarean section. So classical cesarean section is in case of placenta accreta. Placenta accreta means, if you understand, placenta is attached to the superficial myometrium, right? Accreta, superficial myometrium. So for that you do classical section, in which placenta accreta incision is in the upper uterine segment. In upper uterine segment, it is because of placenta accreta, where the placenta is going and sticking to the superficial myometrium. So the problem is either decidua basalis is absent, or the, you can know that there is a Nitta-Bux layer is not proper. So this is about this. Next we'll continue with the other